Welcome, everybody. We are Columbia University and Oldcastle Building Envelope are launching an experiment in New York psychology based on the idea of starting a conference at 9 o'clock in the morning. And the theory was that not a single person would be here at 9. So as a result, I don't have any prepared remarks because we assumed that it would be there would be nobody here yet. And we thought really we're aiming towards a kind of 10 o'clock surge. So let me improvise just a few thoughts. The first is to, one more time, really express my gratitude to Ted Hathaway and Oldcastle Building Envelope for being ridiculously supportive and open-minded. And with this project that we're essentially launching today, the Future of Energy Project, this is a conference which is going to circle around a question, and we want to obsessively work on that question for at least 2 years together. And the question is something like, what is energy, or what will energy be? And it's a ridiculous question because precisely the word energy refers to that which you can't have more or less of. It cannot be anything other than what it is. And yet, energy has a history. There's a very particular history. And that history has been, as a concept, has been forgotten. The word energy appears in almost anybody's sentences if the person would like to be a good person. So it's just whatever you're doing, wherever you are, and you want to indicate your own virtue, you insert the word energy, as if energy itself, by the way, is something inherently good. So, for example, to share it would be a good thing. Nobody's ever saying, I don't want it. So a kind of ideology has developed around the concept of energy. And in a sense, the fact that we've stopped thinking about that word and tend to think about the application of it or the technologies related to it or the policies and philosophies and so on means actually we limit our ability to develop the technologies, philosophies, and policies. So a lot of people are treading water virtuously by as it were, just letting that word energy act as if it doesn't have a history. There have been moments, for example, in architectural discourse when the word energy was a radical word to use. Certainly when Buckminster Fuller was making his arguments through from the late 1920s on and insisting that universe is a patterning of energy, that human beings are radio broadcasts, are electromagnetically formed as patterns, and insisting that geometry was energy. This was a very, very, very strong critique of the way that architecture was considered. And of course, he's not by accident one of the very first figures to insist on an ecological point of view. In fact, he's one of the great polemicists around the possibility of thinking in ecological terms. So again, the word ecology now has, as with the word energy, lost its radicality, and it has lost its ability to stimulate the best thinking and therefore the best aspirations for our society. So the thought of this project is to just for a moment hesitate and expose that word energy again and allow the very, very best thinking to occur around that concept and assume that that concept actually does have a history and therefore has a future. That is to say, very, very important rethinkings of the concept of energy will enable a higher level of performance in society. So again, that we could partner with expertise in the building envelope on questions that are more philosophical is for me just a fantastic thing. It's also a sign of the fact that there is no longer such a clear line between the research capacity of the university and the kind of professional world of production. The world, you could argue that the world today is much more experimental than anything that goes on inside a university. That what is happening in our cities is more radical, even more controversial, more unknown, more of a test than any isolated experiment going on in a university. So the real laboratories of today are the cities, which means that the professionals who engage with that laboratory manufacturers, policymakers, lawyers, architects, designers, engineers, and so on, have to have developed a research capacity, something like we used to associate with the university. And in reverse, universities, to maintain their important cultural role as stupidity reduction machines, have to have developed a kind of worldliness. So there is now a confusion between the inside and the outside of the university. And I think this collaboration with Ted and Oldcastle has been certainly, for me, the most perfect illustration of this mutual desire to collaborate. Not by accident, the loss of this line between the inside of the university and the outside of the university, a line that was first drawn more or less in the 11th century, and still quite strong, an amazing line to have survived so long. The erasure of that line is totally related to the question of energy, as is the case with all drawings of lines and all movement between lines. Again, just to remind you of Fuller's attitude was that every building is a valve, so every building is breathing, and the question of architecture is not the drawing of a line precisely. In fact, it's never the drawing of a line, and he insisted that every line was always perforated and porous. It's much more a question of breathing. And I think in the situation we live today, the university is breathing in more of the outside than it ever used to do before, and vice versa, but it's also breathing out. So this project is launched in that spirit, but also in the same moment that the line between the inside of the university and its outside is being blurred, I think the line between professional and academic, between disciplines, between pure research and applied research, I mean, a whole series of other lines get blurred in that way. So when we say we're going to launch a project to rethink and once again make the word energy the experimental site rather than a word for good, but an experimental site for elevating our performance, this will be a project that will be much more to do with a kind of open source networking of academic communities, professional communities, and much wider communities. So the Future of Energy project will be take something of the form of an interface, and as Matthias was so beautifully responding last night, probably the appropriate word is transformer, since in the world of energy that's what one would do. So the design of some kind of transformer that would, as it were, leverage our best thinking around the question of energy. So this is just a few words to indicate the scope of what we're going to try to do. This means today you're going to hear from people who are really extraordinarily gifted and perceptive and are doing work that is perceptive, are doing work that changes our perception. And they will speak to you in a way with two voices. One to really just tell you what they are doing and which is their role in this kind of reflection upon energy, but also even for themselves to hesitate for a moment and join with us in a conversation about, because even the experts, let's say, in energy precisely may have left the word energy behind. And so we're very interested in that leaving behind and what it is that you would move forward with. So please, all of you going to receive an interview form at the end of today where you're going to have to explain why you turned up on time. It's possible that you're not from New York, in which case I really apologize, and a series of very obnoxious New Yorkers will arrive in about 30 minutes. But you know, I'm very happy that you're here, and I want to quickly introduce Ted to have a few words about energy.
Good morning. I suppose I'm a bit relieved that we're not here to discuss the future of government. I think we have a much easier task ahead of us today, worrying about energy. My name is Ted Hathaway, and I have had the unique pleasure of working with Dean Wigley for, I'd say, the past 5 years. He's a very compelling idea man, and at the outset, I was complaining to him about the lack of interaction between industry and academia, and he took that and ran with it, and we started on a 3-year secondment studying the lack of intelligence in our construction industry. And then as a follow-on, we sort of picked up on this notion that maybe this is the best place to spend the next 3 years, is to examine and try and peel back the layers of what everyone thinks about energy. So I'm very grateful to have the support of Columbia and the hard work, and I'm very much looking forward to today. Thank you.
So before introducing our first speaker, also just a momentary reflection on why we wanted to launch this project at the Museum of Modern Art, because again, one of the crucial lines that is being blurred by the kind of conversation we're interested in is the line between science and art. And this would not be the first time at the Museum of Modern Art in which there has been a conversation here in New York about the extent to which scientists and engineers operate as artists. There's actually an extraordinary rich history of that, and we would like to join that history today. I could refer you to about 30 different exhibitions that have occurred in this building which have been devoted to that subject. If we take a kind of rough idea of what an artist might be, if an artist is somebody that produces a hesitation in your everyday life which causes you to see your life in a way for the first time and to think and to reflect, and because you see your world differently, maybe you think differently, and if you think differently, maybe you dream differently, and if you dream differently, maybe you would start working on a different society. If that's the role of an artist, because it's surely the role of an architect, it is the mission of an architect to create this reflection on your own situation. The architecture is not the housing of everyday life, it's the exposing of everyday life just for a moment. It's a small gesture with an enormous impact. If that's the role of the artist, wouldn't you argue that the most serious people working on the question of energy are precisely changing the way we see our world, and in seeing our world differently, acting differently? So I think in every way, the engineers that have devoted extraordinary expertise to different techniques and technologies and attitudes and policies around the question of energy have thoroughly operated in the way of artists. And of course, we from the architectural and art worlds, who feel ourselves to be a sort of a deep minority of sort of outsiders who then expose things in a sort of marginal way, there's always this sort of fantasy that science is at the very center of things, at the center of government, the center of institutions, and the center of power, economics, and so on. Of course, whenever you meet a scientist, their attitude is very, very, very different. And this is particularly the case in this country, in which science is being defunded even as we speak. So having gone through a wave of defunding of art, we are now in a wave of defunding of science, which seems to me a virtually suicidal gesture. So I think in this moment, again, the scientists in this room and the artists, if we can use those old words, need to be together again. But also I think you really have to appreciate the astonishing creativity of engineering itself. And I think what you will learn a lot of today is just how beautiful, and I really mean beautiful in the sense of an artwork, the work of scientists is. And in that spirit, we really wanted to be at the Museum of Modern Art. We're incredibly appreciative, again, of this ongoing partnership with them. The first speaker is Jeffrey Sachs, who's the director of the Earth Institute at Columbia University. Very much a presidential initiative in the sense that Columbia University, if a university is a stupidity reduction machine, then stupidity about the planet would be probably the biggest stupidity you could have. So Jeff Sachs has led the initiative to develop new cross-disciplinary attitudes towards that. He's an enormously interesting and important figure, so important that he is now in this very second speaking to the president of Albania. And is not here in the room, so he's going to speak to us by video, and the video is about to start. I almost feel like sometimes when a keynote speaker is like too big to be in the room, that it places us in a complicated position. If he was not so big and therefore could be in the room, would we be as interested? So we're placed in this situation of sitting there annoyed by the fact that somebody we want to hear is not here, but if he was here, would we really want to hear him? I don't know. Jeff Sachs.
Hello, I'm Jeff Sachs, director of the Earth Institute at Columbia University, and I had very much hoped to be with you in person, but demands of United Nations travel pulled me away, so I'm very grateful that I can join you for a few minutes, at least by video. I want to thank Dean Wigley for the opportunity to join you in this important symposium on the future of energy. What a great topic for the Graduate School of Architecture, Planning, and Preservation to take on. Indeed, we need a new future from the energy systems that are now in place and actually are at the core of the world economy. And thinking through the meaning of energy and its uses, sources, design, technology, and implications for urban life are absolutely central to humanity's greatest challenges right now.
If you ask a physicist what is energy, you get a pretty complicated answer, but one simple answer is the ability to do work. And that's a pretty useful starting point. We need energy, indeed quality energy, or free energy, as physicists call it, in order to be able to organize things,
move, transform materials, goods, people. We need energy for every facet of our lives, from our cellular metabolism to the structures of our cities, national and global economy.
And throughout history, the ability to harness useful energy, whether it was fire for early humanity, or whether it was the advent of water power and harnessing of wind for sailing or for windmills, has defined the change of civilizations over time. We face a crisis now because of the way that energy is intertwined with our now globalized and highly interconnected economy. To understand that, it's probably best to go back to 1776 or maybe even 1720. Thomas Newcomen invented the steam engine in England at the beginning of the 18th century. His was a very basic version, not very economical in most places, but used already in the 18th century to burn coal in order to create motive power to drive pumps to take water out of deep mine shafts. In 1776, James Watt had a really great idea to build on Newcomen's idea. James Watt, of course, separated the condenser and the boiler of the steam engine, dramatically improving the efficiency of the steam engine for reasons that thermodynamics would only come to tell us dozens of years later. But in practice, Watt had created a highly economical way to harness coal, to harness fossil fuel energy. This was the most important single breakthrough of modern economic life. Really, until Newcomen, but really until Watt's steam engine in 1776, humanity was limited by the motive power that could be gained by animal traction, or by human physical power, or by the amounts of energy that we were able to harness in wind and waterfalls and water mills and windmills. And that wasn't very much. The other main source of energy, I should have said, was biomass. And already by the late 18th century, vast forests had already been cut down or were in the process of being cut down in England and other places to provide the fuel for even the nascent steel industry and other industries, which basically literally ate up vast amounts of timber to produce relatively meager amounts of iron for use in the economy. With the steam engine came a breakthrough that we live off of for 2.5 centuries since. And that is the ability to tap into a vast store of quality energy in the form of solar power that was embedded in the plant and animal cells that got buried in the earth and eventually in geologic time produced the coal, petroleum, and natural gas that drive the world economy. We have been a fossil fuel age, really, since Watt opened up the way to a steam engine-based industrialization, which England led the way, and then with the discoveries of how to drill and harness petroleum, especially in the internal combustion engine invented in the second half of the 19th century, how to tap into another great storehouse of fossil energy, another form of solar power buried in the membrane of dead animal tissue. And then in the 20th century, with the gas turbine and other inventions, mobilizing the energy in methane in the form of natural gas that is often associated with oil reserves or is now increasingly harvested on its own, for example, in the hydrofracking of methane in shale deposits in many parts of the United States. This is quite a story. It's a story of ingenuity. It's a story of harnessing a vast, vast supply of energy resources. It is at the very center of our economy worldwide, of our geopolitics. Think of how many wars have been fought over oil, implicitly or explicitly. Of our national politics, think of the fights over hydrofracking or big oil or the battles between oil and renewable energy sources and all that goes into that around the world. Fossil fuels have made the modern world, which brings us, of course, to the drama today. Fossil fuels have been a great thing, except for the small footnote that when used at the scale that we are now using them, and the scale that continues to grow, they now threaten our very survival. This is the side effect, the unanticipated side effect of a world economy built on fossil fuels. It's not exactly a new story. It was already realized in the 19th century that when we burn coal, the combustion produces carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide enters the atmosphere. A significant part of what's burned and emitted stays in the atmosphere for centuries or millennia. And carbon dioxide, as with a few other gases in the atmosphere, has the greenhouse effect, meaning that when the ultraviolet rays from the sun come and warm the planet and the Earth re-radiates infrared rays back out into space, carbon dioxide, also nitrous oxide, methane in the atmosphere, hydrofluorocarbons, and a few other chemicals, have the property that they trap that infrared radiation. The molecules vibrate and they re-radiate that infrared radiation. And rather than the Earth radiating its infrared back out into outer space, it gets trapped by this layer of greenhouse gases and it warms the planet. This is an unfortunate side effect of the physical realities of the planet. Now, carbon dioxide is a good thing in the atmosphere up to a point, because without it, human life wouldn't be possible. That greenhouse layer of gases keeps the Earth warm in a natural temperature range hospitable for life. Without the atmosphere, the Earth would be as cold as the moon. But we have that greenhouse layer. The problem is we are now adding to it by digging up the fossil energy, burning it, and by now, since James Watt came along with his wonderful steam engine, humanity has increased the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere by about 40%. In the pre-industrial era, there were 280 parts per million of carbon dioxide molecules. Now there are 400 parts per million of carbon dioxide molecules. And the implication of this, when combined with the other greenhouse gases like methane and nitrous oxide, is that the average temperature of the planet has already increased by about 0.9 of 1 degree centigrade. This doesn't sound like much, but it's already creating a tremendous havoc. The higher latitudes in the planet warm a lot more. They create feedbacks, such as the melting of sea ice, which changes the Earth's dynamics and accelerates the process of warming. And moreover, the greenhouse increase from burning fossil fuels has not yet been reflected fully in a warmer ocean, because like a big bathtub, it takes a long time to warm up. And so there still is a lot of momentum of warming, even beyond the 0.9 degrees centigrade, from the emissions that we've already put into the atmosphere, maybe even an increase up to 1.5 degrees or even 2 degrees centigrade based on what humanity has done so far. This is our most challenging and most complicated problem. The world economy has grown up with fossil fuels. Aside from this mere detail that they threaten our survival, they've been awfully good to us. I should add as a footnote, of course, that coal is awfully polluting for other reasons. And so even coal, aside from the greenhouse effect, poses many challenges in air pollutants that, unless otherwise carefully handled, gives the disastrous outcomes that we see in China today, where dirty coal is burned in a dirty way and the cities are so smog-filled and is so filled with particulates that it is a massive, massive human health hazard and massive cost of shortened lives in China. But our big challenge is we need energy. We have a sophisticated world economy. We have 6/7 of the world's population still living in developing countries, looking at the developed countries and saying, I want to be like you. So I want to use more energy. I want to have better mobility. I want to have better transport. I want to have clinics that have electricity, emergency rooms with electricity, office buildings that are cooled in hot summers, and industry, of course, that requires vast amounts of energy for transforming goods and producing the things that improve human life. And by the way, I work in a lot of places around the world that don't have modern energy sources, that are still biomass-based, that don't have electricity. It's not what you want. It is associated with unsafe water, lack of sanitation, heavy labor in low productivity agriculture, lack of effective healthcare, lack of effective schools, health hazards throughout the community, many, many years of lost lives on average with life expectancies often in the 50s or in the 60s rather than in the high 70s or 80s as in the high income world. Energy is crucial for economic well-being and for human well-being and human health more generally. So what do? One choice is to continue along more or less as we are right now, burning fossil fuels, despite the idea that we're running out, there's enough there. Maybe they're unconventional. Maybe they're the Canadian tar sands. Maybe they're the heavy oils in the Orinoco in Venezuela. Maybe they're the tight oil and the tight gas in shale deposits in the United States. We're not running out of fossil fuels anytime soon, and not soon enough in a way to prevent the greenhouse effect from threatened calamity, because we're on a trajectory not just of temperature increasing by 0.9 of 1 degree centigrade or a half to 2 degrees centigrade, but maybe 4, 5, 6 degrees centigrade. What would the implications of that be? It could be sea levels several meters higher than now as the great ice sheets of Antarctica and Greenland crack up. It could be mega droughts in today's dry but not hyper-arid regions. It could be massive flooding in places that have plentiful rainfall but would suddenly find themselves in a 4-degree warmer centigrade world of having cataclysmic extreme storms. With higher sea levels, think of the world's megacities, New York City, of course, but all over the world, cities really from time immemorial, but certainly in the last two millennia, have been built on riverbanks, and they've been built on coasts where sea-based trade is feasible. And with a sharply rising sea level, the threats are disastrous. Even Hurricane Sandy of last November, which created perhaps $60 billion of destruction, damage, and loss of life on the eastern seaboard of the United States, was exacerbated by a 1 foot increase of sea level over the last century. That's just 1/3 of a meter. But the possibility is of meters increase. And of course, higher temperatures threaten every other aspect of our lives, and perhaps most essentially, even of our food supplies, which would be profoundly, profoundly threatened in many parts of the world. And the consequences would be cataclysmic. So that's one choice, business as usual. Continue burning fossil fuels, continue going on the course we're on. The other possibility is a radical transformation of how we use energy, what our primary energy sources are, how we deploy it, how efficiently we use it. That's the future of energy that we need. We need, in essence, to decarbonize the world's energy system by 2050. Even as the world population and world economy continues to expand, and maybe even triple by 2050 in aggregate size of total production, we need carbon emissions to go down sharply, perhaps by half or even more than half by 2050, to remain even in a bound of relative safety, though we're already into the danger zone. So in terms of U.S. emissions, for example, for a rich economy, we might have to reduce our carbon emissions by 80% to be consistent in a world in which poorer countries are going to be using more energy, and the rich countries have to take actions to help make way in an equitable way for the whole world. The future of energy that we want, therefore, is a decarbonized energy system. This poses profound challenges, many of which are unsolved. We know on paper, and we know by experience, that there are alternative energy sources, of course. Solar power, wind power, geothermal energy, nuclear energy if it can be used safely. Even fossil fuels, if combined with an unproven but potential technology called carbon capture and sequestration that grabs the CO2 produced from fossil fuels and stores it underground in geologic deposits. Time is very, very short, 2013, and we need to make radical changes by the middle of the century. This has to happen all over the world. It has to be politically acceptable. It has to be economically organized. It has to be technologically designed. It has to penetrate into the core infrastructure of thousands of cities around the world. It is the biggest challenge that humanity has faced in the aggregate, and we're not yet ready to do it. We're starting, I hope. 21 years ago, the world agreed on the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, which called on the 193 member states of the United Nations to avoid dangerous anthropogenic interference in the climate system by restricting greenhouse gas emissions. But 21 years later, we haven't turned the needle yet. We haven't even changed the direction, much less decarbonized the energy system. I mean, face it, we are at unprecedented levels of CO2 with 400 parts per million being the highest CO2 concentration in the preceding 3 million years on this planet, we continue to increase and increase at an accelerating rate because of the growth of the world economy. The oil gas lobby is as powerful as any in the world. Vast money to spend on confusing the public, by the way, saying, don't worry about it, everything's fine. Go for a drive if you're concerned. Burn more oil. This is a disaster. We need brainstorming, not obfuscation. And while we have promising technologies, we have the profound challenges of getting ourselves organized in practice in financial terms, in economic terms, in political and regulatory terms to make that transformation. Now, the member states of the UN this September, 21 years after the Climate Change Convention was adopted, took an important decision. Not in the headlines, but I think it can play a big role. They said that in the post-2015 development agenda, the world will put sustainable development at the core of our concerns, and there should be universal goals applying to rich and poor countries alike to achieve sustainable development. First, what does sustainable development mean? In brief, it means economic development that is socially fair and environmentally sustainable. And so we're taking what was an economic agenda and making it an economic, social, and environmental agenda. The second thing the world community agreed is that there should be bold goals to help orient the public towards sustainable development. These will ostensibly be called Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs, which will follow the MDGs, the Millennium Development Goals. I believe that having bold global goals on sustainable development can make a difference. I very much like what President John F. Kennedy said when he was talking about the goal of peace. He said, by defining our goal more clearly, by making it seem more manageable and less remote, we help all people to see it, to draw hope from it, and to move irresistibly toward it. So I believe by defining our goal of sustainable development more clearly, indeed by having perhaps 10 sustainable development goals, including the move towards sustainable energy for all, we can help people to understand what this challenge is, to draw hope from the practicality, and therefore to help the world move, I hope irresistibly, towards a safe energy world. We need trajectories or pathways to accomplish this major goal. We need more planning, what we call backcasting, saying 2050, we better be here. How do we get from where we need to be to where we are today so we can run the clock forward and make those changes in a timely way? We need technology road mapping, and we need a rather complex multi-stakeholder process in every city in the world to change energy systems, to change transport systems to clean electric vehicles and public transportation, to move to cogeneration of power and heat, to have building codes in which our residential and commercial structures use energy with much, much greater efficiency, and many other changes that combined could take us on a new trajectory so that by 2050, we really do have an 80% reduction of carbon emissions. And countries around the world have taken these steps. It's feasible. It is technically feasible. One can sketch out the pathways, but the practicality is what counts, not what's in the books or the journal articles. We need to move. Finally, in terms of moving, let me make two points. One is we're going to need a whole generation of creative brainstorming, multi-stakeholder problem solving, backcasting, finding pathways, road mapping of new technologies, research, development, demonstration, and diffusion of new approaches, many tools In other words, to achieve sustainable development. UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon has kindly honored me by asking me to help create a worldwide knowledge network around practical solutions for sustainable development. And we have created the United Nations Sustainable Development Solutions Network, or UNSDSN. And at the website of www.unsdsn.org, you can read the report that we issued to the Secretary General on what should these SDGs look like, how can they be achieved, what kind of pathways could get us there. And I am thrilled that Columbia University is secretariat for this worldwide network. I'm thrilled that around 100 universities around the world have already joined the network, and I expect hundreds more will do so very soon. Some of the world's leading companies are part of this. Many of the world's leading scientists, engineers, development leaders, business leaders are part of this solutions network. But the second and final point I want to make is that it will be, I believe, in the cities where the practical changes are made. Yes, nations, national governments debate these issues, but cities actually do what national governments only talk about. New York City has made major advances in both thinking about sustainability and in promoting particular approaches. And after Superstorm Sandy last year, Mayor Bloomberg put on the table a major plan to block this kind of flooding, or at least most of it, but with a pretty hefty price tag of $20 billion. And that's only a patch job to what we really face with the rising sea levels. Cities are going to have to take public investments in transport and energy systems, in water and sewerage systems, pollution control, in public health measures to achieve sustainable development, and especially a sustainable energy system. And with breakthroughs in technology, green roofs, solar panels throughout the cities, electric vehicles powering urban mobility together with the mass transit of various sorts in the cities, cogeneration of heat and power, as I mentioned earlier, and many other innovations. It can be cities that lead the way to sustainable development. After all, 70% plus of the world's population will be in cities by 2050, perhaps significantly more than that. And the creativity that the cities can show, in my view, will be path-breaking. I say all of this because the Graduate School of Architecture, Planning, and Preservation builds our environment and designs, thinks about the strategies for creative, prosperous, healthy, and sustainable cities. I think this will be the great challenge in the years ahead. Energy is at the heart of the challenge, but it's not the only challenge. Food, water, health, productivity, jobs, inclusion are all part of the sustainable development challenge. I really thank the Graduate School for taking on the future of energy, and thank you for inviting me. We have the Sustainable Development Solutions Network Secretariat at Columbia University. I'm sure we're all going to work together with our own great city of New York and with cities around the world and with peoples and universities all over the world to solve this problem. Time is very, very short. Our potential is high. The stakes can't be larger. Today's symposium can be an important step on getting us in the right direction. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Jeffrey. He said nice things about the School of Architecture. School of Architecture was formed in 1881. At that moment, America was exactly at the middle, at the cusp of rapid urbanization. So it was, you know, 40 years earlier, America was 20% urbanized. 40 years later, America was 50% urbanized. So basically, Columbia University wanted an architecture school in the face of urbanization. I think we no longer are in a moment where a school of architecture could, as it were, deal with the question of cities and their future for a university. The question of the city is for the whole university to think through. There's not a single division of the university that you could not argue has as its primary responsibility the question of the city. But what if the city is a subset of the question of energy? What if, in fact, if you would empower all the universities of the world and say, with all of your capacity, you're only going to think about one question for the next 50 years, which would be the question of energy, I think the city would then emerge as a subset of that. And when we say cities, of course, you have some sort of image in your head. And that image is completely stupid, which doesn't have anything to do with your own internal stupidity, which is your unique contribution to our planet. It has to do with the fact that nobody really knows what the cities are. Cities have escaped our capacity to envelop them with concepts, which is exactly why a university needs to think the question of city. So what I'm saying to you is if maybe the most important mission of a university is to think the question of the city, and even the city is in this moment escaping our understanding, if you now consider the possibility that cities are a subset of a bigger question of energy, which is even less clear, then this would be one explanation for why we launched this Future of Energy project, to actually try to produce at least the beginning of some kind of framing of a question, what is energy? And for sure, we can't ask the question, what is the future of the city, without first asking the question, what is the future of energy? So again, I think the architecture school, again, would like to be the host of a conversation that it actually is not qualified to make. We can do the hosting. So now I'm going to introduce the host of the next panel, which is David Benjamin, who's the astonishing director of the Living Architecture Lab at Columbia and has produced a kind of cross-species experiment where he radically graphs architectural thinking and biological thinking. So he works with biologists and architects to produce new kinds of species of thinking. It's a wonderful person who will then introduce the next panel, David.
I just wanted to say a couple of quick words to introduce the first panel and then jump right into the next round of presentations. As you know, there are going to be three panels today, and we have kind of organized and curated these panels in a loose way to question, broaden, and reframe the way we think about the future of energy. There are a few different themes and obviously a lot of different overlaps and complex ways that these presentations over the afternoon will come together. But I wanted to mention that in setting up this symposium, one issue that we wanted to explore head-on is what we're thinking of as kind of a spectrum between paradigm shift approaches, including new technologies and new design approaches. So from paradigm shifts to more incremental change and incremental improvements, including the way we can alter human perception and human behavior as it relates to the future of energy. So this first panel will try to kick off a discussion about paradigm shifts and what they mean and all of the issues that come with those. And what I'd like to do is briefly introduce our first presenter, then we'll have a presentation, same with second and third presenters, and we'll save some time for discussion between the panelists and also questions from the audience at the end. Kate Orff is our first presenter. She's director of the Urban Landscape Lab at Columbia University, Graduate School of Architecture, Planning, and Preservation, and she's also founder of SCAPE. In 2012, Kate won the very prestigious United States Artists Fellowship. Recently, she was listed by Elle magazine as one of the 9 women involved as fixers for mankind. With a background in environmental science, the political and social sciences, and the fine arts. She basically merges ecology and form, strong form proposals to create rich, biodiverse, textured landscapes that magnify the relationship between people and place. Scape's projects range from a pocket park in Brooklyn to a 1,000-acre landfill regeneration project in Dublin, and it's a pleasure for me to welcome Kate and her presentation.
Thanks, David, and I'm very happy to be here to talk about the future of energy. And I'm very pleased to be following Jeffrey Sachs's remarks, because I think what I have started to think about and what I wanted to talk about today was really about not only the future of energy. Let's see if I can forward this. Here. Let's see. Next. 1 second as we move forward here. If I hit next, and I hit pointer, that works. There we go. I just have to push it really hard. It's not only the future of energy that I want to talk about, but actually how energy regimes and how the sort of past energy regime relative to the combustion of coal in various forms, or hydrocarbons in various forms, natural gas, has basically created a condition in which we're actually, when we talk about the future of energy, we're actually talking about the future of life, not only life on in terms of human health and human wellness, but actually the future of biodiversity and on our planet. Try that again. I think in the meantime, maybe someone could get me a new battery on this. Sorry, everybody. There we go. All right, so I figured that I stand here, and then I'll point the pointer. So yes, so, and also I come to this as a landscape architect, because the regime of kind of coal and natural gas and oil extraction has been a sort of a one-way extraction process that generates waste, right? One of the unanticipated consequences of the sort of 100 to 200 years of burning coal and energy has been not only waste products in the form of carbon dioxide, but a whole suite of unintended consequences that include sea level rise, temperature changes, ocean acidification, and so on. So as Professor Sachs mentioned, I mean, I've pulled in some images of how sea level rise is affecting our immediate environment. These are some images of just the Jamaica Bay area, which is the subject of my current Columbia studio. So this is, in a sense, the New York region's kind of, immediate challenge relative to the unintended consequences of the past of energy. And in a sense, what I want to talk about is, the idea of, how we need to begin to be acting in the landscape, not only in a way that's sort of proactive, that is adaptive to the sort of trajectory of climate change that we've already kind of set out for ourselves, what Jeffrey mentioned as being up to several meters of climate change, but actually how we sort of need to be acting incredibly proactively and incredibly in a very direct way in terms of not only mitigating and designing the kind of present in a very aggressive way to enable a lifeline between this sort of bridge while we discuss decarbonizing our economy. There are species and people that need a bridge to a kind of a future. This is an example of sort of island building research that's happening now in Jamaica Bay that's kind of a temporary stopgap measure that keeps that entire bay from being basically completely underwater. But also, to think about, what I wanted to talk about is this notion of, okay, we're architecture school, we're planning, preservation, landscape architecture. So what are we doing and how can we engage in this issue of climate change in a way and the future of energy in a way that's not simply in a kind of techno-managerial mindset of like, okay, we'll just do energy like this and everything will be fine. So what I want to do is draw some lines and begin to connect the dots, very much as sort of Professor Sachs just did, in between the interrelated concepts of energy, climate, public health, food, and actually our physical landscape that we inhabit. So I'm going to speak about my project called Petrochemical America, which is a research project that was basically conducted very much as this slide shows, which is very much out in the field, looking at how energy is produced with a special focus. And this is the cover of the book with photographs by the amazing photographer Richard Mizrach. Basically to look at a case study of one place in the world that had been, at least in the American context, sort of focal point or ground zero in the past of the energy landscape in America. And now it's sort of shifted overseas. We've got the Houston Ship Channel. We've got other refineries that have gone around all throughout the world. But in the early 1900s and the mid-1900s, this was it, right? So this is a map showing the zone between Baton Rouge and New Orleans and the sort of the snake of the Mississippi River. And due to a lot of various reasons, due to the sort of sedimentation process of the Mississippi River, this became a kind of a place with this kind of holy trinity of transport in the form of the Mississippi River, easily accessible carbon underground in the form of this sort of sediment that's been trapped and captured and cooking for millennia, and then also a sort of a very brine from the salt domes and so on, but also a very willing and vulnerable kind of population in which all this extractive processes could take place. So I'm going to flip through some of Richard's photographs fairly quickly, but I think what they do is sort of paint the picture of how energy lives in the landscape and has a footprint not only in its very direct condition, but also, as Jeffrey has just expounded upon, has a much broader impact on landscapes and lives. So, this is one of my favorite photographs of Richard. It's called the Norco Cumulus Cloud, because this is an image of a landscape which I think if you blurred your eyes might look somewhat pastoral, right? Oh, maybe it's Central Park with a kind of a beautiful cloud formation. But this is actually the New Orleans, Norco, the New Orleans refining company, oil refinery company, and this sort of artificial weather pattern that it creates. And so the residents have different names for the different types of clouds of noxious gases that it creates over time. So I guess the point that I'm trying to make is that energy, landscape, life, and health are kind of intertwined. And the point of this project, the Petrochemical America project, was to kind of draw a cognitive map around that interrelated set of processes so that we can begin to describe the issues. And then when we think and speculate about future energy regimes, be they kind of dispersed and scaled down or largely or consolidated, that there are kind of the suite of impacts that we can consider. And these images, I think, especially this one, speak to the kind of scale issue that is the topic of this conference relative to the position of the individual in the world and these sort of massive scales of energy that are required to power the global economy and the American economy. And in terms of the effects on the landscape, there are a myriad of effects which, frankly, are traceable in degrees and degrees of separation to the extraction of coal, oil, and natural gas and the combustion of hydrocarbons. But, for example, this is if you know the Louisiana landscape, this is simply this is almost an image that represents the entirety of the southern part of the Delta in that case. This is a sort of a drowned bayou, which has been drowned for a number of reasons, which I'll go into later. And also the sort of social, Jeffrey Sachs mentioned this, that in his sustainable development goals that the social, environmental, and economic goals are now married. But I think as we look in the past, actually social and economic goals were very, very separated. In fact, this is an image of Union Carbide, which is now Dow plant, next to the cemetery of a poor African-American freedman's town that had been moved to create the space for that plant. So I'm going to go through some of my slides very quickly. This is several years of research, but just to say that in every case, what we tried to do in this project was to map, visualize, and sort of develop a sort of cognitive process in which the intricacies of energy regimes could be traced directly and their influence could be directly traced to people's lives and the health of the landscape. So this is why that this is how this image came to be, and that is that the Mississippi River was developed over time into a series of, from its sort of looser meander, was organized into a series of sort of arpent patterns where large plantations that farmed sugar, cotton, indigo, and so on, developed in a perpendicular manner against the river. And what happened is that as after emancipation, many of these larger plots of land were then sold to energy companies in the form of, you know, what was then Texaco and so on. So what happened was that you have these huge consolidated parcels of land, and living next to those parcels of land were the freed African-American slaves and also poor white communities. So this is why you have this kind of extreme social justice issue in this region, which was exemplified by the previous image. And in the book, it's called Petrochemical America. It's not called, like, oil in America, because one of the things that we've learned and what we've been so fascinated by is how oil, natural gas, and coal not only produces, you know, in the American context, I think if you ask the person on the street, they would talk about energy in the form of driving, you know, like what do you put in your car to make it go? But the fact is there's an entire suite of petrochemicals and products that are all derived from these hydrocarbon substances that affect our environment and that basically create these residual waste products. So this is, I think Jeffrey Sachs probably said it much better than I could say it in any sense, but in a way this is kind of a map of those very phenomena that he was talking about. How oil, and this is also a map of the chapters of my book, which go from oil to infrastructure, waste, displacement, ecology, food, and back into landscape. And the point of these chapters is to begin to show how all of these interrelated global and specifically American crises, if you will, are interrelated to and go back to the energy question. So these chapters begin to show this sort of downward spiral, if you will. We all are very familiar, unfortunately, now with this metaphor of the kind of tipping point in the downward spiral of how these extractive processes cause displacement of community, enhance regulatory context, and cause a heavy polluting industry to relocate overseas, which then causes displacement of communities in places like Burma or India, places with maybe less democratic institutions to protect. The book also goes into how to break these cycles, and we try to break them through a number of not only energy projects, but also kind of community-based projects that begin to taper down, in fact, the use of energy through known and successful case studies. So I'm going to go now through the sort of process of the book, but this is one of Richard's photographs and how we began to, because again, I think a big role for architects and designers is to visualize these processes, which are invisible. So what I tried to do is begin to sequence his photographs, work with him, and he began to photograph different things over time as we collaborated, and pull out the different scales of sort of implication, whether it's global, whether it's regional at the Gulf scale, whether it's the Mississippi scale, or whether it's very site-driven, and begin to develop a chapter, and this is the first chapter of the book called Oil, which begins to sequence and contextualize those photographs and kind of loop them into a larger narrative about landscape and energy. So this is, in fact, the first image of the book, which is both a geological cross-section of how the lower Louisiana, the lower Mississippi Delta, became through time this sort of geological hotbed and oil hotbed that it was. It shows how these sort of layers and layers of sedimentation of the river began to cook up these fossil fuel pockets. And then in the diagram here on the right, you can see all the sort of deep water offshore drilling wells that are kind of tapping into this vein, if you will. And the drawing also shows a time scale, so it's both sort of a geological section and a time. And as Professor Sachs mentioned, we're now up, this is an overlay of carbon dioxide emissions, and we're now actually up and off the charts. At the time of the writing, we were something at 393 parts per million of carbon dioxide. And now as we move forward, we're kind of literally off the map up at 400 parts per million. So I think it shows in a very, very, you know, in a sort of geological time scale, the impact and the sort of dramatic increase in the excess carbon dioxide that has been placed as a pollutant, if unintentionally, into the environment. The book also, we kind of look at, there's this old saying in Louisiana that the flag of Texaco flies over the state of Louisiana, but it's not even Texaco anymore because Texaco has been bought by Chevron and so on and so forth. But and the what I try to do is to trace actually how energy itself and the incredible complexity of extracting energy from underneath the earth in the form of oil wells actually gave birth to the typology of the modern corporation. So this is a kind of family tree of corporations and showing how energy and the extraction of energy gave birth to this entire kind of newly coordinated regime. And an image showing how the extraction of energy over time and the what I hope will probably be discussed later today, this the notion of EROI, or energy return on investment, becomes lower and lower as we dig deeper and deeper into the earth and consume more and more energy. So below the line, you kind of see the depth of oil wells and above the line, the kind of consumption pattern. And actually how I think the modern global economy, and in particular the American economy, has been fueled by this presence of presumably cheap, although the sort of the consequences of energy and the sort of factors are not necessarily incorporated, but have basically fueled almost like an economy that is based on consumption. And how these sorts of products and petrochemicals live in the landscape. And this is, if you're an engineer, as many in my family are, you are both horrified and excited by this image because it shows the incredible sort of ingenuity of how we've begun to break these petrochemicals and fossil fuels into a myriad sources of other product types. But also, if you know about atrazine, if you know about vinyl chloride, you also know that these are among the most dangerous products in the known to man. So the book goes through how we derive and store energy in the earth, this kind of coupling of infrastructural and natural systems, crack and frack the sort of products of the energy regime into a series of usable products, the extent to which, this image shows the extent of offshore oil rigs, and now we're very far off the continental shelf with Deepwater Horizon platform, and how what's often called externalities in the industry are, in fact, deeply affected. So, and with this last image, I showed the image of Deepwater Horizon. That happened during the writing of the book. So we know also that waste from this kind of one-way extractive process not only lives in the landscape, but also lives in our bodies and lives in our communities. We also trace the history of how these very small African-American communities in Louisiana have been affected, and look at Morrisonville and some other Taft and other small communities that have been literally moved due to this sort of extractive processes and the environmental contamination that lie in their waste, in their lit. But then more importantly, what I wanted to show in this image is now how our current energy regime has actually pushed offshore and essentially globalized the pollution and the kind of negative effects of the oil extraction industry. And also Jeffrey Sachs mentioned war and the other sort of things which are often not necessarily taken into the equation. So I'll take 1 minute to talk about this image, because this is also an image that shows how we've moved from this kind of looped and living processes and that are kind of typical in a kind of a functional landscape and one with structure and function, and have moved really towards this one-way extractive notion of nature, in which saltwater intrusion, rising sea levels due to climate change, and wetland subsidence, all things that have been affected by and put into place by the sort of extraction of oil and natural gas in this zone, have wrought. And so a pairing of a sort of a looped and living landscape with the and crisis, frankly, everything in teal or dark teal here is slated to be underwater by 2050, and how this this has affected not only, again, human health and life, as I showed before, but the biology and biodiversity of the regime. And we depend on these systems and cycles to be functional in our own in our food system. So we also developed a series of drawings that contrast the sort of pre-industrial nitrogen cycle with the one-way extractive system of based on natural gas, which is a, you know, a sort of an energy-intensive process based on fossil fuels, which has created a kind of Faustian bargain where we have in the Midwest, where we're spraying atrazine, where we're spraying and we're dumping excess nitrogen, we have this sort of low-quality corn and soybeans that have developed in the kind of dead zone in the Midwest that have actually moved themselves downstream and created a dead zone in the Gulf. So whether or not we kind of can draw the line so directly, but the future of energy is also deeply tied to the future of food. And finally, just to wrap up, the notion of how energy and lives in architecture in a very direct way. So I would say that architects and designers have to speculate broadly not only about how this cheap energy regime has literally built an American landscape that is a sort of a machine for consuming oil and petrochemicals, and that houses are bigger and bigger and farther apart. Cities are certainly the sort of promise and the answer in this regime, but actually how the products themselves that are characteristic of the building industry are also fueled by fossil fuels. And in a way, the landscape of sort of the petrochemical landscape of the lower Mississippi has enabled this kind of new landscape of, or contemporary landscape of sprawl, and that the one feeds the other, and these two are also intertwined. So unless we can, as architects, not only address problems of the building envelope and problems of energy, but address problems of settlement pattern that in fact fuel the extraction process, then we'll be, it's a lot to think about. So finally, I'll sort of close with this notion of the case study and moving forward, because the book shines a spotlight on specific smaller energy projects and case studies that have shown how change happens, right? Because the big thing of, you know, thinking as an architect is thinking about how to generate change. And I'll close with a statement on this notion of the future of nature, right? Because we've been thinking about nature in a certain way, which requires the extraction of, frankly, of a sort of plankton and these sort of chemicals that have been, you know, cooking underneath the ground for centuries and centuries. So, you know, what we need to, I think, move from is a new energy regime that thinks about nature in a different way, in a way that is not sort of in a one-way and extractive process, but in a way that is looped and living, and in a way that doesn't create these kind of residual waste products and crisis points for what you would call, quote-unquote, the sort of environment as we know it. So I thought I would close with a slide to provoke the sort of conversation with my teammates, my partners here, that is an image of solar panels in a national park, and a kind of a mapping of solar panels relative to open spaces. Because I think the future of nature is not one that is about wilderness, it is about, or one that is about cities, it is about a kind of a nature that is cultivated, a nature that is understood in all of its complexity and all of its interconnectedness. And it is a nature that is going to have to develop together, whether it's wind, solar, or water energy. Together that we will have to develop a kind of a new regime of energy in partnership with that nature. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Kate. I actually found your whole presentation both horrifying and exciting. And maybe something that we could return to in the discussion is this idea that there's the possibility that in the future of energy, a kind of glucose economy could replace a petroleum economy, an economy based on biotech and renewable sugars and biomass, and a way to replace not only the fuel that we need and use in a more renewable way, but also the products, as you discussed, the chemicals and products. Our next speaker is Dean Whatmoor. Dean works at Verdant Power, which is one of the world's leading companies in the innovative field of free-flow hydropower. In other words, hydropower without the use of civil infrastructure like dams. Dean joined Verdant in the summer of 2005 while assisting in the testing of a turbine prototype in the Merrimack River in Amesbury, Massachusetts. Dean has provided logistical support for Verdant Power's 2008 RITE project, R-I-T-E project, which includes the world's first installation of six turbines gathering continuous hydropower underwater in New York's East River off Roosevelt Island. Dean was born in Coventry in the UK and moved to the United States in 1983. After graduating with a degree in finance, he served as a commissioned officer in the United States Army and later worked as a financial advisor for Morgan Stanley before coming to Verdant Power. Dean Whatmoor.
Thank you very much, David, and thank you all for coming out today. I am Dean Whatmoor, and I work for Verdant Power. And today we're here for the future of energy. So what I hope to do today is take you on a real-life experience of taking a green technology in the United States from prototype on paper to commercial design. The average rule of thumb is it takes approximately 10 years. We're on the 13-year mark, so we're in and around that range. I'll go into a little more detail on why we're not at the 10-year mark. However, this will give you an idea of the technology, what we've done, how it got started, and also basically the challenges that are inherent in the technology and in the industry in general. So without further ado, I will figure out this. That wasn't it. Okay, so Verdant Power. We were a company started in the year 2000 by three members and a couple of engineers. And the goal was to create a clean energy for moving water. Obviously, we've talked about the carbon footprint, the ecological and environmental impact in relation to the food supply, as Kate mentioned earlier. So how are we doing this? Well, we share a lot of similarities with wind that I'll touch on later. But the major advantages that we have are we don't use any dams as in conventional damming. So we minimize the ecological and environmental impact. And in relation to solar and wind, very valuable technologies in their own right. However, our advantage is that we are very predictable. So if you think of a case of tidal power, if you have a turbine in the water on tidal power, we can tell you how much power we'll generate tomorrow, 3 weeks, 6 months, 10 years, 30 years down the road, simply by looking at tidal charts. If you go up a level and you look at a river system that flows constantly 24/7, stick a turbine in the water, now you have constant power production. So now you have projects that are available on a larger scale, such as baseload power. For your smaller village scale type of power, you'll typically have a tidal situation where you'll have episodic movement of the waves, and you can deliver distributed generation. And I'll touch on that more later. But you're basically putting the power in close proximity to where it's going to be needed, near the load. So that's basically what we're doing, is deriving clean power from moving water. And we'll go into a little more detail of exactly how that began and how it's being done today. So we've been around since 2000, as I mentioned. Since then, we have a lot of experience. We've built and tested three different types of prototypes for Verdant Power. I was initially hired to work on the turbine that you see on the bottom of the slide. That's in the Merrimack River in Amesbury, Massachusetts. And since I didn't mess anything up on that particular project, they hired me back. So I'm still here. And So what we have installed is a total of 17 turbines. Anybody who's familiar with our technology will notice that we ultimately went with the one that looks like a red cone in the upper right of the screen. It looks very similar to a windmill. And we're currently on our fifth generation. So we have two projects currently underway as we speak, the New York City Wright Project, or Roosevelt Island Tidal Energy Project. And then we have the Cornwall, Ontario project with focus on the entire region of Ontario. So none of this could be done without a lot of support. And here are some of our supporters, certainly not all, but some prominent ones. I won't go into detail on each one of them. However, I will share with you the initial process of beginning a process like this began with deciding on New York City due to the toughest regulatory environment. The adage is, if we could make it here, we could make it anywhere. So we decided Roosevelt Island was the optimal place based on our water speed studies. I also work on the resource assessment team, so I spend a lot of time in boats. And we did a town hall meeting with the residents of Roosevelt Island and their representative aldermen, basically explained what we were planning to do, put turbines in the water right next to their home. And unanimously, a large majority of the population were very much for it, so much so that the alderman later came to our president of our company and shared the fact that if we need them to load up a bus full of constituents to drive all the way up to Albany and lobby on our behalf, they'd very much be behind the process. They very much like the idea of having this renewable island or renewable energy right in their backyard. So a lot of major players involved, including the citizenry that have kept this project going to date. So it all began with phase one. You saw the picture of the first generation turbine we decided on. It's a triple bladed axial turbine, so it looks very similar to a wind turbine. Major differences are it's smaller. We use water to power it instead of wind, and it's a few less moving parts. Since we're putting this thing underwater, we have approximately a 10-year design life, hopefully extending that beyond that. But in order to put something under the water, we need it to last. It gets very expensive to pull things in and out of the water all the time. So what we did, we built in redundant seals, used food-grade lubricant, et cetera, and came up with the design that you see there. That's our first generation. The people that are wearing the survival suits are our founders. Remember, this was at the beginning of the company, so it was a bootstrapping operation. And the four of them were lucky enough to sit in a Winnebago on Roosevelt Island and freeze their rear ends off because they ran out of propane. So they talk about it like the scene from Jaws, where they're all sitting in the boats comparing scars and war stories. That's what it's like listening to these guys recall the experience of working on the Alpha 3 or Generation 3 turbine. So I have a lot of respect for them for getting out there and doing it and still managing the company today. So on to the Generation 4. This is what we did in 2007 that I was primarily involved in for the logistics planning and also assembling the turbines. Again, three-bladed axial flow. The blades on our turbines do not have a variable pitch. In other words, they do not adjust their angle of attack for the water as wind turbines do. The reason for that is we need to keep it simple, fewer moving parts, less things to fail. We can put it underwater, set it, and forget it is the mentality of that. Also, I'd like to add that the blade design is optimized for any given region of water. We found that to be the best blade design. It has a passive yaw system, which means it operates like a weather vane. So as soon as the tide changes current or direction, it simply swings around on its own, and you'll have the rotor in the back. And every 6 hours when the East River goes from ebb to flood and vice versa, the turbine just rotates on its own. So we don't need any mechanical, any electrical actuation. It's a dumb system. A lot of our competitors like to talk about how smart their systems are. We like to talk about how dumb our systems are. So a few more specs. We installed six, a total of five produced power. One was a dynamometer. Simply put, it just collected data and information and gave us an idea of what was going on with the other turbines. And as was mentioned, we had a world's first with a grid-connected array of turbines. It was the world's first and basically put our company on the map. I would like to say that in the beginning, when we filed our first permit to put the six-pack in, there was no regulatory framework in place with the U.S. government for micro-hydropower. What we had was conventional hydropower, the big dams. So we received this big tome, and we're told, go through this and pull out what you need to create this framework of this process. So a collaborative effort basically laid the groundwork for the regulatory frameworks to where Verdant and other companies in the hydropower industry could basically have a set of rules to follow in a process. So for us, it was a very fortunate point because they named it the Verdant ruling, and that was FERC, which is the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. So this rather boring looking slide is actually tied into the phase two environmental monitoring. What we did to basically assess the safety of fish travel in and around spinning blades. When we first presented this project to the environmental regulators, putting spinning blades in the water where fish are didn't seem like something everybody wanted to just jump and sign off on. Because there's a lot of scrutiny as far as the environmental, as there should be. But what I'd like you to take away from this slide is that you see the six turbines as they were installed. Each one of those purple beams basically represents a sonar, split beam transducer. And they simply, you have far field on the outside of the turbines, infield amongst the turbines on either side. So essentially what you do, if I've got a laser pointer on here, is anything that's traveling north or south is going to get picked up in any of these sonars. Likewise, if you look at the side view of this transect, here we have the fish frames. We have a total of eight. Each one has three transducers. And you can see they look at a vertical water column. So in other words, we capture everything that comes in the turbine field, whether it's vertical or horizontal. And what we found is that the fish during the operation of the turbines generally were very, very limited numbers. When the water's fast enough and spinning fast enough to where the blades can produce power, most of the fish move to the side of the river to the slower waters where they can travel without using as much energy. Conversely, when the water slowed down and our blades were not spinning, then we actually had more fish in the area, but just passing through generally. I will touch on more a little bit about the environmental, as I'm sure some of you are curious and want more information. This slide just simply shows the water to wire efficiency, just basically how efficient the pump and the motor work together, which is basically what a turbine is. And it's only for one turbine. The blue line represents the water speed over a given tidal cycle, and the red line represents the turbine's power output. So as you can see, the turbine's output is highest at the fastest moving water. When you put all five turbines together on the graph and plot it, you'll see a very a much more smoother line here for the power curve. Now, this is for the East River, which is a tidal estuary. So every 6 hours, it ebbs and flows. That's why you see differences in the water speed. If this were a chart for a river, you'd have a very smooth blue line straight across. And with the turbine, you'd have a straight red line going straight across, simply because of the consistency of the flow of the water. So our accomplishments to date, I mentioned the Verdant ruling. I mentioned the world's first grid-connected array. I think the biggest thing I think stands out to most the people I meet with is the environmental impact that we were able to prove that this type of technology can and does allow for safe fish passage because the blades aren't spinning very fast. You're talking around 33 revolutions per minute, maybe 40 revolutions per minute, very slow. So if a fish were to hit one of the blades, the fish experts have basically determined that it would likely just have a glancing blow off the fish and likely not kill it. But there's your answer, if a fish were to hit it. So we logged 9,000 consecutive turbine hours, generated 80 megawatt hours to the grid, and we filed for our commercial license in 2010. Here's a copy of our license, and I'll direct you to the website www.therightproject.com. If any of you would like more information on the project, it's in four volumes. It's a bit heavy reading, so if any of you are interested in more detail on the environmental information that I just mentioned, I would refer you to volume two, so please feel free. And at any point after that, please feel free to contact me if you have any questions or any member of our company regarding that. So there's the license that we filed. So our commercial project and our commercial turbine is the one on the left, which is the Generation 5. And there's the old Generation 4 that we tested in 2007. We basically shrank it down, used less material, streamlined it. It's more hydrodynamic. A few other modifications are it uses a brake, an emergency brake, so it can be turned off anytime, anywhere, via on-site or a remote computer. Why would we want that? The government may say someone's fallen in the water, a boat hit one of your turbines, etc. Whatever the reason is, we can control these things at all times once they're installed. We use a food-grade lubricant just in case it were to leak into the water, which is highly unlikely since we have redundant seals, basically two seals to keep anything from getting into the environment. And that's about it. This major difference here is simply because when the turbine changed directions in yaw, basically what we noticed was there was some flutter. So what we did, we took that off, went back to the cylindrical mast, and everything worked out fine. If anybody's familiar with our 2007 project, we broke some blades. So we had Mayor Bloomberg down there, Governor Lieutenant Patterson, had the ribbon cutting, everything was going hunky-dory, everybody left, and then I think we had some switch trip, but about a week later, we basically had blade breakage. So the original blades were made out of steel and fiberglass, and slowly, one by one, they started failing in a cascading effect. Didn't make us feel very good at the time, but it is an engineering effort, and it is a prototype, and we like to say we've broken more blades than people have installed in the renewable energy. But to take away from that, what it allowed us to do was identify how close you can space turbines, since we were allowed to still monitor the water speed and the data and the output of the functioning turbines. And it led to the next design of our new blades, basically. So we switched to a composite resin. We took the whole thing to NREL, the National Renewable Energy Lab in Colorado, had it tested at 280 times its working load. Got it back here, put it in the water to test it on an old Generation 4 body. We had the new rotor assembly, passed with flying colors. So we moved on to the anchoring system. One of the biggest costs of putting energy, the renewable energies, is deploying these things. One of our largest costs is the deployment costs. We used to put one turbine on its own individual pile in the pilot project. This time we're being a lot more efficient. We're putting three turbines on one triangle, as you can see there. I won't go into too much detail on the chart on the left, but basically if we have deeper water, we have longer blades. And if we have faster moving water, we put a bigger generator in it. And what the table on the side does is just give you that speed to rotor size and the type of generator involved. So this is the side of the project. Here's our initial six-pack are marked by the buoys. This is a bird's eye view of Roosevelt Island. We have Manhattan here, Queens here, Roosevelt Island looking north. The new project will extend from here all the way to the northern end, which is evidenced on this slide. So the black rectangle represents the 20 acres of the 1 megawatt project. 1 megawatt, by rule of thumb, is approximately enough power to power 1,000 homes. It's not a massive amount, but it's a very good start, considering that the energy being produced will be clean energy. Also, in contrast, you have our initial six installation, the six turbines, which took up around 1.6 acres. And as you can see, this whole project here itself is in the east channel of the East River. It's the least trafficked, and we only take up about one-third of the river in the width. Most of the traffic in New York City travels in the East Channel, except when the UN's in a session, and then they go through various security measures. But either way, we're in the less traveled of the two channels with very fast-flowing water. So each project has very similar type of equipment. This is a quick generics slide of what's involved. You have our turbines, you have their cables going to the main cable, onto shore, into a cable vault, and then into the interconnection to the grid. Basically, what I'd like you to take away from this slide is that most of these projects are out of sight, out of mind. So there's very little to see, as evidenced by the disappointment in a few people's faces when they come to see the turbine project in New York City and all they see is three buoys because they're underwater. I think it brings a good point that you can still do this and have minimal impact, both aesthetically and environmentally. New York's mentioned on there because it's our prominent one. As far as projects, it led to other things. I mentioned the Canada project. Ireland's looking at the Shannon Estuary. Turkey is looking to add more power to their existing dams. Zimbabwe is trying to protect the largest lion and elephant preserve in their country. So they can't build any more dams without affecting that. So they're talking to us about what potential they'll have by tapping to their existing water and dams with our technology. And the UK has, the Crown Estate has estimated that the UK around its shores has approximately one gigawatt of utility scale power in the United Kingdom. So where does this all leave us? Where are we going in the future? Well, we certainly don't think we'll be the answer to everything. However, we do feel that as fossil fuel extraction continues to rise, which can obviously affects fuel prices for food and everything else, we think our technology will be part of a combination of other technologies that exist today and also technologies that have yet to be developed. There's a lot of great minds thinking about this globally and obviously in this symposium today. But just an idea of what you can do if this is on a village scale. So if you think about having a river, putting a turbine in there, you can now have clean water through reverse osmosis. So you can have electricity powering lighting, but you can also have clean water. You can have pumping for irrigation, obviously, for agriculture, aeration. You can provide combination power plants. So I mentioned one of the disadvantages of solar and wind earlier is intermittency. The wind doesn't always blow, the sun doesn't always shine, and we can fill in those gaps of that predictability. However, if you combine these technologies and other technologies out there, such as high-capacity battery storage, you then have a very very predictable type of power that can obviously create a base load in larger scales and also store power, which is exceptionally important. And we think that's where the challenge is today, is that we think solar and wind will basically lead the charge and the developers around that for battery storage. So basically what I hope I've done is given you a little insight on what a real-world experience is from taking a prototype to commercial design. I mentioned it was 10 years. We're at 13. That is because I believe we're the innovator, and New York is an exceptionally tough regulatory environment. And since there was no federal framework to begin with, we developed that and made it a lot easier for competitors to enter the market. And the way we look at it is we all move forward together anyway. So we're very excited to hear about other technologies, and it's a small world. I look forward to the Q&A. Thank you all for coming out today, and thank you very much for listening to me.
Thanks, Dean. It's really interesting to get a sense or a kind of flavor of implementing, you know, one of these kind of innovative world's first ideas that have to do with energy and the future of energy. You know, it strikes me a couple things. One is that although it's invisible, you know, it potentially has this massive impact as it rolls out both in New York and beyond. And I also can't help wondering, you know, what Kate's diagrams would look like if they were applied to your, you know, power company, and as the history of that power company moves on. So we can save some of that for the questions and answers. Our next speaker is Jonathan Trent. Jonathan is a scientist and a visionary based at a NASA Ames Research Center. After earning his PhD in marine biology at the Scripps Institute of Oceanography, Jonathan did postdoc research at the Max Planck Institute in Germany, the University of Copenhagen in Denmark, and the University of Paris in France. He returned to the USA to work at Yale Medical School and then Argonne National Lab, before moving to NASA Ames. In addition to working at NASA, Jonathan is an adjunct professor at UC Santa Cruz and a fellow of the California Academy of Sciences. Jonathan's research in this remarkable way has ranged from marine biology to molecular medicine, from astrobiology to nanotechnology, and I think you'll see some of that in his work today. He recently started a grassroots movement called Global Research into Energy and the Environment, GREEN, at NASA, and that is the basis for the project that he has developed called the Omega Project. So as you'll hear more from Jonathan, Omega is an ocean-going photobioreactor system to grow algae for making biofuels, food, fertilizer, and other useful products while treating wastewater and sequestering carbon. Jonathan.
Well, so I don't know about you, but I hear people like Jeffrey Sachs talk about this incredible predicament we're facing with something as important as energy. And I think when we hear the potential problems, we need to start thinking out of the box, really out of the octagon. We have to start thinking how we're going to solve this problem. And so what I thought I would do this morning is give you a perspective from sort of a broad view of where we are. And I thought what we would start with is looking at our solar system and its formation. So this is a model of how the solar disk formed our planets. So we started with this dust cloud around a central star and generated by basically sweeping out all of these particles, we formed what has become the planetary system around the sun. And if you look at the sun relative to the Earth, you realize that we represent a rather minor component of our solar system, and the gas giants versus the icy planets versus here's the Earth. And we talk about Mars as being, gee, if we really are going to mess up the Earth, let's go to Mars. I thought, because I have a lot of architects in the room, I'd like to play a little bit of a thought game in thinking about what it would mean to go to Mars and really make a colony on Mars. And the first thing you have to realize is that going into space is an incredibly hazardous process, that the life expectancy of an astronaut exposed to the space environment, even in low Earth orbit, is about 15 seconds. And that if we wanted to go to Mars, the process of going to Mars is a massive undertaking, and we cannot go on a camping trip there. That is to say, we can't pack enough food to make the trip, which is a 3-year round trip, although we can go to Mars and back without landing in about 508 days coming up in the year 2018. And there's some wealthy people thinking that they'd like to do this. I think they're really, really nutty, because the reality is that this is going to be a really, really difficult process. Thinking about Mars, though, is incredibly valuable. And the reason it's valuable, and the reason it's valuable to this audience, is because we have a lot of data about what the surface of Mars is like, thanks to such things as these rovers, which have been wandering around the Mars for quite some time. And we've collected an enormous amount of information about what's a terribly inhospitable planet. And the reason it's useful for you as architects to think about these types of habitats on a planet that is so inhospitable is because it teaches us about what we need to think about with regard to a virtually resource-limited, resource-negative kind of environment. If we were going to live on Mars, we would carry our atmosphere around under our clothes. We would be on a planet where, on the warmest summer day, the temperatures might reach 20, 22 degrees Celsius, which is comfortable. But that's the temperature it would be at our feet. The temperature at our head would be minus 40 degrees Celsius below that. There's no atmosphere. There's no water. There's no place for food. We would probably live underground, as shown in this sort of stylized image, with collecting solar energy in various forms. And we would grow plants to be able to survive in this terribly difficult environment. Again, going outside would require that we would be surrounding ourselves with a functional atmosphere. This is the ultimate thinking about what it would be like in a resource-limited environment. Now, the consequence of thinking that way leads us to consider what we call life support systems or closed-loop life support systems. And that is to say, we have to think about every conceivable resource, and wastes becomes a verb only. If you're not using something again and again in a cycle, then you're wasting that thing. And this is an important thing for us to realize, especially in the context of where we are now, at a planet that is fairly remarkable relative to the other rocky planets in our solar system. I mean, Venus having a surface temperature of about 400 degrees Celsius, a temperature that melts lead, an atmosphere of sulfuric acid, basically a runaway greenhouse, and virtually no water. Mars, which, as I told you in some detail, is totally inhospitable, and Mercury is completely out of the question. So we really don't have much choice. Now, the other interesting thing about our planet is that it's a water planet. Now, Venus had water, Mars had lots of water, and both of those planets lost their water, just as we would have lost our water if there hadn't been a biosphere here, and we can talk more about that later. But let's consider where we are. Let's consider the reality of our species now at 7 billion en route to 9 billion people. And let's consider what resources we have and what limited resources we're going to have to be dealing with as we start to accommodate this population. If you look, as we heard Jeffrey Sachs talk about, the history of energy in the United States is all about coal, natural gas, and fossil oil. Going out to the year 2035, it's basically business as usual in the models that are presented, with a very, very minor contribution from the collection of renewables and biofuels. So here we are at 2013. 85% of our energy right now is coming from fossil sources. And don't be fooled. As we heard from Kate, this is not just for driving our vehicles and warming our buildings, but this is powering our whole economy. This is the reality, and this is what's driven our whole success, where success is defined in the population that we're at as well as the kind of lifestyle we have. And perhaps the most important contribution is the production of nitrogen fertilizer by the Haber-Bosch method using methane or natural gas. We have plenty of renewable energy sources when the world demand right now is about 15 terawatts, and you can see that solar is 126,000 terawatts per year, geothermal is 92,000, and biomass is about 172,000. And you can calculate that there's plenty of different energy sources, although most of these energy sources are used for making electricity. That is to say, geothermal is used for electricity, solar is used through photovoltaics for electricity, and biomass is one of the few that we can use for making a liquid fuel. Now, we've heard about the prospects of improving our ground transportation by using hybrids, which get much better fuel economy, and we can, of course, electrify our ground transportation, and this could be a great solution as we go forward. And I leave this part of the problem to you, the problem, of course, of not polluting our atmosphere with with the fact that we have to make the electricity somehow, and ultimately now we're doing that with primarily hydrocarbons. Ultimately, we could do it with solar and wind. Now, there is a problem, though, and that even if we solved our, in quotes, solved our problem of ground transportation by electrifying our whole fleet, we can't fly airplanes.
looking into the energy density of batteries versus the energy density of liquid fuels, it looks like the prospects of flying and continuing to fly airplanes really requires that we continue to make some kind of liquid fuel. Now, ideally, that liquid fuel would be a biofuel, which would be sustainable and potentially used and built and put together in a way that wasn't going to compete with agriculture. In other words, if we're going to focus on biofuels, it has to fulfill the criteria of being affordable, enormously scalable, because right now in the United States we're using about 18 million barrels of fuel per day. That's 42 gallons per barrel, and it's 18 million barrels per day. It has to be sustainable, and it should not compete with agriculture. And what I mean to say is that we're going to need vast quantities of these biofuels in order to produce the liquid fuel that I've just described. And we have to ask, so what are the sources? So if you look at a map or a graph of gallons per acre per year produced for biodiesel, this isn't ethanol, but biodiesel, soybean is about 50 gallons per acre per year, sunflowers 100, canola is 160, jatropha is 200, and palm oil is 600. And microalgae, which is the source of over 90% of the fossil oil that we get from the deep ocean, came from microalgae that lived in shallow seas in the early Cenozoic, is 2,000 to 5,000 gallons per acre per year. Clearly, microalgae is the best solution. Now, if we put ethanol on this graph, we would be looking at fairly low production rates as well. So if we plot the area of land we would have to cultivate to produce soy oil, it's shown here, versus the amount of land that we would need to grow algae, shown in the smaller green box, and this is to produce only the jet fuel used in the United States in the year 2012. Which was about 21 billion gallons, or about 60 billion liters of fuel. This is the area we'd need in soy, and this is the area we'd need in algae. Algae is still about 200 square kilometers, so it's still a really large area, but it's a lot less formidable than trying to do our fuel needs in soy. Now, arguably, we could raise the average IQ in some of the states in this area if we grew algae there, judging by current events that are going on. But we really have to think about what we're doing with regard to the ethical question of whether we're going to use potential food sources to drive our cars. And I think the answer has to be no. And then, in fact, algae has to be able to fulfill the criteria of scalability, affordability, sustainability, and not compete with agriculture. These are essential criteria if we're going to use algae as a source of our biofuel. And when I say algae, I mean microscopic organisms, shown here in comparison to a human hair. So these are tiny organisms that their lifestyle requires them, that they store fat to be able to survive the ocean environment, which is a feast or famine kind of environment for these organisms. So can we fulfill these four criteria using algae? That's the question. And the first thing we need to analyze is, how do we grow algae? Because there's an industry now that exists for growing algae that's been around for quite some time. And there are two schools of thought. One says that you use a very inexpensive shallow channel with a paddle wheel to stir the algae and keep them afloat, and they're called raceways or open circulating ponds. And the other school of thought says, no, let's use these things called photobioreactors, which are light-driven bioreactors, or PBRs, which are shown in this picture here. Both of these systems are very effective at growing algae, and both are used globally to grow algae for high-value products. So this, for example, is a picture of an algae farm in Hawaii called Cyanotech, which grows a substance called astaxanthin, which is in fact a food dye for salmon. Very high value, $5,000 to $7,000 per kilogram production of astaxanthin. And these open pond systems have been used globally to grow these types of pharmaceuticals, nutraceuticals, and food additives, cosmetics. And they can also be grown in these closed systems shown here in Spain and another one in Germany. Now, these systems work because the systems are growing high-value products. But where would we put these types of systems in our cities? Obviously, we wouldn't be able to put anything like this in Manhattan. And the other problem would be that in order not to compete with agriculture, we're going to have to find a source of water and nutrients that are not going to compete for water and fertilizer with agriculture. And the answer is that you can grow algae, particularly these microalgae, on wastewater. So here's a picture of the wastewater treatment plant in San Francisco. The wastewater is produced in this particular plant at about 65 million gallons per day, and it's dumped offshore into San Francisco Bay. There's about 2 billion gallons a day produced in the greater Manhattan area from about three different wastewater treatment plants. And what we would need to do if we were going to build these open ponds is build them very close to these wastewater treatment plants because we can't use energy to pump water any great distances. In fact, in order to create this type of a system near San Francisco, we would need about 1,280 acres of land to contain about 5 days' worth of wastewater of about 325 million gallons to grow our microalgae, which is good. We ultimately would be able to produce biodiesel to accommodate about 20% of the diesel needs for the city of San Francisco if we could grow algae in this 1,280-acre area. The land costs in San Francisco are probably not as high as Manhattan, but they're still prohibitively expensive, and the prospects of building something like that near San Francisco is completely impossible. In fact, if you then say, but we'll pump the water some distance, I just told you that that would be impossible. The other problem with open ponds is evaporation. It's estimated that in order to grow algae to produce our biofuels, we would need about 1 trillion gallons of water a year just to replace the evaporation in open ponds. 1 trillion gallons of water a year is almost as much water as we use for all of our agriculture in the United States in a year, so that would be an impossible addition, and therefore competing with agriculture. The fact is that these systems, neither these open ponds nor these photobioreactors are scalable. In addition, they're not affordable because of the costs of producing either these systems of closed bioreactors and the pumps and all of the rest of the materials that would be involved. And clearly, if they're not affordable and not scalable, they're not going to be sustainable. And finally, it's true that they compete with agriculture because even if we build these things some distance, we decide to bulldoze down New Jersey or parts of New Jersey and create our system outside across the bay, it still wouldn't be accommodating the fuel needs that we need. So I want to tell you about another idea. And this is a concept that I came up with some years ago. The system's OMEGA, and it's an acronym for offshore membrane enclosures for growing algae. So let's imagine that this is going to be a new mission for NASA, for Spaceship Earth. And the mission is to find a replacement for fossil fuels in less than 10 years. And the goal of the mission is to address the problems of climate change and ocean acidification and dead zones. And if we could really do this, it would have a major impact on national security because we'd now be distributing land, we'd be distributing oil or fuel production around the world. We started our model system by thinking about doing it in San Francisco Bay. And the reason we thought San Francisco Bay would be interesting is because there's a lot of smart people there, but mostly because there's a very interesting location that has what we needed for our experiment. An island called Treasure Island, and for us the treasure was the wastewater treatment plant. So the goal here was to use the wastewater that currently goes from this plant and is pumped offshore fresh water dumped into the surrounding water, and we would redirect this water now into these floating bioreactors to provide a basis for growing algae to produce fuel. So this is how it works. We build an enclosure and we put treated wastewater in it, and we add an algal strain that produces oil, and we make it out of something flexible, and it uses wave energy for mixing, and it's sitting just below the surface, and of course it uses solar energy for the algae, and they grow on CO2, which is what all plants are doing, and they produce oxygen. This is all good. And they use the solar energy, but the heat from the sun, which is a problem on land because the bioreactors overheat, is dissipated in the water. The algae produce fuel and other valued products. And now the issue is, how do we build this thing without getting a bunch of people mad at us for other stakeholders? Ships and fishermen, and how do we do this without irritating a lot of people? Well, I mean, we're trying to build a fuel system here. I mean, and we heard from previous speakers, including Jeff Sachs' argument, that this is an imperative we have to figure out how to do. So the goal here is to take a waste stream, in this case, treated wastewater, and we actually need a source of CO2 to make the algae grow really well because they're carbon limited, and we put this into these floating enclosures. This then, combined with solar energy, allows us to take advantage of wave energy to provide mixing. The temperature, as I mentioned, is controlled by the surrounding water, and the algae then that are produced are producing not only oxygen, but they produce biofuels, and their remains are used as fertilizer or even food, we can talk about in a while. Now, the system is contained. And this is interesting because we heard from the previous speaker that we need to worry about the environmental impact of things, and obviously that's true. But what do I mean by containment? What I mean is that we build a modular system, and if something happens to one of our modules and the thing leaks, the wastewater that leaks into the ocean or into the bay is already the same wastewater we're dumping there, and the algae that leak into this water are eaten by the local marine life. More importantly, these are freshwater algae living inside our container, so they die in salt water. We build this thing out of some simple, cheap plastic like linear low-density polyethylene, and we make it modular so that we can fix and recycle the system. So if you think this is a good idea, I thought it was a good idea. and I managed to convince a few people who had some money that it was a good idea. And I started this. Omega, by the way, is an acronym for offshore membrane enclosures for growing algae. And the project started with this bright idea in 2008. And it got funded in 2010 by the California Energy Commission to the tune of about $800,000. And then NASA chipped in a $10 million additional dollars to do a feasibility study. And in this feasibility study, we looked at the biology, the engineering, the environmental impact, and the economics, but the goal was to ultimately create a tech transfer system, deciding whether the system could be picked up economically by other people. So let me quickly just tell you the engineering, the biology, the environmental impact, and the economics were studied in various sites. We set up three laboratories. One of them was in Santa Cruz. We called it our Skunk Works. One of them was in San Francisco at a wastewater treatment plant. And then we had a bay site where we were looking at environmental impact. We set up laboratory studies. We looked at all different aspects of algae growing in wastewater. And we mostly importantly, we built tools so that we could use modern tools to allow us to grow and develop this algae culture system. Perhaps even more importantly, we built what are called photobioreactors of all different designs. And in tune with what Edison said, we discovered 10,000 different ways the system wouldn't work. We finally came up with a system that actually functioned, and we then took this model and very simple system, and we scaled it up and used it in San Francisco in some wastewater at a wastewater treatment plant, in some seawater tanks that we constructed using wastewater and using CO2 to drive the system. So this shows you a model of what we built, and we harvested algae, and we studied different methods for harvesting algae, and we also studied how effectively the algae could remove the toxins that are in our wastewater. because now our wastewater is a whole pharmaceutical complexity of toxins as well as heavy metals. We have some interesting papers about this. And the contaminants are very effectively removed by these microalgae. We studied the recovery and recycling of the wastewater because water is a really important issue in our cities, and particularly in the cities of the future. And we found a method for recovering the wastewater as drinkable water in a very straightforward and simple method, which I'd be happy to talk to you about later. This system we tested for its environmental impact by setting it up in a harbor. And you can see that what we took a clean system in the ocean, we have a problem with biofouling, or what's called biofouling, which is stuff growing on the outside of it. And so we looked and developed cleaning methods for this, as well as studying the impact on animals. So the main animals that are there are, in our environment, are sea otters and birds. And we looked at how these animals interact with this. These sea otters were actually quite good at cleaning the surface of them, and we're hoping that we'll train a whole group of these animals to keep these reactors clean. Ultimately, we would like to build a system that looks something like this. And so an offshore system with a source of wastewater, a source of flue gas for carbon, and then an offshore floating infrastructure to support this system. We did a techno-economic analysis of this system, and what I can tell you, if you look at algae in this way, in terms of its scalability, its non-competition with agriculture, its sustainability, and its affordability, it's certainly going to be scalable. Not only is it going to be scalable because we have large bays off our coasts, but we actually have a sea level rise issue that's going to flood major areas and make it even more scalable. It doesn't compete with agriculture because it's offshore and uses wastewater. It doesn't use water, it doesn't use fertilizer, and it doesn't use land. And therefore, it should be a sustainable system. The problem is it's not affordable. And so the solution to affordability is shown here. We basically turned this system into solar panels, wave energy generators, and wind energy generators, and most importantly, we include in this infrastructure an aquaculture component so that now the system becomes self-energy generating, which helps to drive the pumps as well as produce extra energy. We have wastewater, we have carbon sequestration, and we have aquaculture. And very quickly, if you look at the biofuel cost, if you only make biofuels from the Omega system, in dollars per liter, it's prohibitively expensive. But if you add wastewater treatment, which is a process that's of value, and you add electricity generation, and finally you add aquaculture, you see you can bring the cost down. So now the system becomes more affordable and, in fact, competitive. How big a system? We're talking about 1,280 acres for San Francisco. That's to clean their wastewater, not an impossible task. And what we do with the plastic, when we finish using it in the ocean, we move it on shore and we use it for growing crops. So this is a concept that I'm sure you're familiar with called cradle to cradle, in which we now think, what are we going to do with all this plastic? There are problems with plastic in the ocean. Well, the answer is we use it on shore, and then finally we use the plastic after it served its purpose on land to recycle as a hydrocarbon for making fuels. So finally, we're talking about building a biofuel. We're talking about a food, additional food, both in terms of liberating our land so we're not growing biofuels, but also growing fuel and food from offshore. There are no obvious other options, and this is kind of future adaptation to sea level rise. So let me just end by saying the next question is where? And I can tell you, I thought I would do this in the United States, but having spent some years now trying to figure out where in the United States I would do this, I realized that there are a lot of other places that make much more sense in terms of early adoption. And I've been spending a lot of time traveling around the world. The only place that I found in the United States that was suggested as an option at the Pentagon, when I had a meeting at the Pentagon, was Gitmo. Potentially a good place to do it. But I've now been talking to people in Tonga. I spent 2 months in Japan. I just came back from Korea. There's a project planned for Thailand. The Dutch have just approved a place off the coast of Rotterdam Harbor, not off the coast, but in a marine enclosure in Rotterdam Harbor. And there looks like some pretty promising prospects in other places around the world. So let me end there, and we'll have the panel for questions.
Well, thanks a lot, Jonathan. That was amazing. I think, you know, we've had three amazing presentations, three different perspectives. It's tempting to want to start to talk about some overlapping issues or some distinctions between them. I think the theme of water is really interesting, that inevitably it crept into each of the presentations. But I just wanted to start the discussion by maybe taking a step back and thinking about overarching frameworks. And in other words, you know, if we're thinking about the problem as outlined by Jeffrey Sachs and each of you in your own way, I'm curious to have a little bit of reflection about whether we need to be thinking about centralized approaches or decentralized approaches, or in other words, if we should be trying to integrate these innovative ideas or just consider them independent ideas that are very loosely connected. And so just to describe that a little more, I mean, I think if on the one hand we have this framework that was kind of popularized by Al Gore of stabilization wedges. You know, so if we think of the graph of carbon emissions over time that we've seen a couple times already today, if we're going to reduce that, what do we need to reduce that? Do we need like one like incredible innovative approach, or do we need a series of approaches that, as innovative as they are each only going to reduce that overall amount by a small effect, and therefore we need a kind of array of separate and distributed approaches? Or should we be thinking, I guess, about not necessarily one home run approach, but about a way of integrating the separate ideas, or maybe, to borrow from Jeffrey Sachs, of kind of mobilizing this great logistical effort that would have to talk about the way that algae interfaces with underwater power, with the petrochemicals that we are demanding in addition to demanding energy. And so I just wanted to turn it over to each of you to offer a few thoughts about, like, overall approach. Like, what should we be looking for? And maybe more crucially, to us at School of Architecture, who should be designing those frameworks? So any of you, maybe hear a couple of your thoughts about that.
I'd like to touch on it. I certainly think the future will be integration of the various technologies. I also think that going forward into the future that right now we have a national grid, so to speak. So we ran power lines all over the country, as most countries do. So we have a grid system, basically. I think the move in the future will be towards distributed generation, putting the power basically in close proximity to where it's needed, to the end user. It won't be possible in all ways, but I do think with integration of the various technologies, I think that is possible. And I think it's important to integrate them because together as a whole, they are a lot more competitive and a lot more viable when you look at the pros and cons of each.
Yeah, I would just add, too, that when I see one of your final graphs, Jonathan, of the sort of coal, fossil fuels, and then the sort of thin the thin veneer on the top of the alternative energy sources, it does seem to imply to me a kind of shift in, you know, desirable or, you know, I don't know how exactly achievable or not, but the way that, we're thinking about energy as sort of an enhancement of the fossil fuel regime and not addressing big things like consumption or, and your last point about affordability, in both cases, I was struck by the comment of the Verdant Power will power 10,000 homes, right, which is quite a lot, but also it's assuming a kind of a high consumption level for each of those units. So I think we have to integrate the concept of consumption in the discussion, and also the fact relative to the affordability argument that for 100 plus years that sort of oil and gas extraction regime has not included what are called externalities, which your system includes as you've designed both of them. It is inclusive of an externality approach, which is saying, okay, well, we're not going to, you know, account in our business model for massive oil spills, or we're not going to account for CO2 emissions because that's somehow a burden that is shared, not directly to corporate stakeholders. So I think also we have to try to get to an apples to apples approach, which is frustrating from the outside because I feel like your systems that you've developed are incorporative and inclusive of the notion of a complete system, whereas what we're trying to quote unquote enhance is simply not so.
I think that's an incredibly important point to make in terms of the system that I described to you. The Omega concept is to create an ecology of technologies. So the concept of waste goes away. The concept of waste is simply what is that resource, what could that waste resource be used for? But we need to get real. I mean, what we're talking about and what Jeff Sachs was talking about was we have a society that's based on a fossil oil-based system. It's a 150-year-old industry. It's about $5 trillion industry, right? And the United States represents, I mean, to put it in statistical numbers, we represent less than 5% of the world's population right now. And we're using over 20% of the world's resources. So India, for example, at 1.2 billion people, they represent about 17% of the world's resources and currently using about 4% of the world's resources. But India wants to live like the United States. If they did so, they would use somewhere on the order of about 85% of all the world's resources. Just India, India alone, living like we live in the United States. So I think Kate's point is extremely well taken. What we really are talking about in question of affordability, we're talking about our lifestyle. We're talking about a lifestyle that's being exported globally through our media and through our internetworking. And that lifestyle is not sustainable. And so the issue becomes, can we as a nation evolve toward a more sustainable system without melting down? That is to say, without going through some cataclysmic change in which our social fabric gets sort of chaotic and then has to reform some way. Judging about what's happening with our central government right now, it may be we're in a meltdown mode that we're going to have to go through. I don't know. I mean, I'm currently not employed because of what's going on. I mean, at least I'm on furlough. So I have to tell you, NASA supported this project at $10 million based on this idea that we were doing a life support system, like I showed you for Mars. But in the end, they completely withdrew their funding. And the reason is that the current NASA administrator, Charlie Bolden, used to work for an oil company. I mean, he's on the board for Marathon Oil. And he saw this as there was, of course, a conflict of interest when he tried to shut down the Omega project, and there was a big mess about this. And you can watch a Rachel Maddow program about it if you're interested. But the reality is that our country needs to go through some major rethinking of what our priorities are and how we're going to go forward with changing the way we're doing business. And personally, if you look around the world and you want to understand what countries are doing to adapt to the future and the future of energy, just follow the money. Where are we investing? Who's getting, we're subsidizing our oil companies right now in giving them more money than we give to the Department of Energy. And no projects in these really heavy alternatives are being significantly funded, not to the tune of where we go with our fossil energy efforts. So it looks like the if you follow the money and you look at our behavior rather than at our words, it looks like as a nation we're focused on continuing business as usual. Fracking is this major breakthrough. Nobody's even considering the environmental implications of fracking. At least it's sort of swept under the table. So we're not serious about doing anything, which is why I'm going all these other places to look for a nation where there will be a real momentum for long-term sustainability. Why I spent 2 months in Japan, why I just came back from Korea, I went to South Africa. I've been going globally to find a place to install this idea, or at least to help to instigate the idea.
One quick follow-up is, I mean, I think one of the exciting things about all the projects is their ability to connect energy to other important issues, you know, the products that we use, the water that we use, the waste that we produce. What about cities and buildings? You know, to return to what Jeffrey Sachs said at the end of his presentation, that he thinks cities are going to be a crucial part of the solution. Maybe it would be interesting to hear a few words, you know, from each of you again about buildings and cities.
Well, my sort of instinct on that would be to turn back to your earlier provocation about scale and the idea of externalities, quote unquote, and scale. Because I think when you have these massive global systems of, you know, I showed the image of the Gulf with the sort of oil platforms and that are literally unseen and not necessarily in our cognition maps, that scaling down, I think, in itself represents a great opportunity to begin to connect production and consumption within the scale of the person or within the scale of the community. Because what I was really interested in with Omega and with the Verdant Power, too, is that these are scales of energy production that really nest in a very interesting way with scales of inhabitation and settlement, right? Like, that you know, the city is a certain scale, and we're sort of, you know, extracting energy from points far afield and power plants. But if you kind of begin to think about the scale of the individual or the scale of a community and how we can define community many different ways, but that to me is incredibly promising because it's a visual connection, and what I was trying to do was map these massive disconnects between consumption and production, the places and the effects on lives and landscapes. So to me, I get very excited when I see these two projects, and I think about not just the scale of the city, but just scales of people and in relationship to energy production. That seems to be very promising. The 10,000 houses, or the aqua farm, the aquaculture, and your project relative to San Francisco as a sort of a visible unit.
I can comment as well. This question of the cities, in my view, is that we have to start looking at what we now see as waste products from the city as resources from the city. And how can those waste products become resources? So it's estimated that there's on the order of 400 trillion gallons of wastewater produced a year globally. So it's this enormous number. 80% of that is totally untreated. When we looked at the problem of trying to generate a biofuel, we addressed it from the standpoint of how could it be scalable and can it be affordable and what would be the environmental impact. And of course it should be something sustainable. The Omega project was somehow, to me, it was an obvious kind of approach from the standpoint of major cities in the world are coastal. Most major cities are using the water around them, coastal cities, to dump and rid themselves of this waste product, which is high in phosphate and high in nitrogen and causing local algae blooms, which are leading to those dead zones that are coming out of the Mississippi into the Gulf. And that The reason there's a dead zone is because you get an algae bloom. The reason the algae kill what's in the water is because at night they respire, right? So during the day they produce oxygen, but at night they use up the oxygen and they make the water anaerobic. They take all the oxygen out of the water, which suffocates the animals in the water that need to use oxygen from the water. So they become dead zones. So taking advantage of the cities and looking at all the resources in the cities, the various aspects of the cities, both historical and future, and taking every component of that and using it for power or using it for a resource is what this whole system is meant to be about rethinking. And it is true that our cities, I mean, it seems clear that there's this huge immigration to cities that's going on right now. And that's going to continue for the foreseeable future.
I think we have a few minutes left for the panel, and I want to allow the audience to ask some questions or make some comments. So maybe if anyone has something, yes, go ahead.
Yeah, so the city of San Francisco has got, and this is interesting to realize, the city of San Francisco produces about, from that one wastewater treatment plant, which is at Hunter's Point, 65 million gallons a day on average over the course of a year. They can store about 200 million gallons underground. But what's interesting, and I'm sure this is true of Manhattan as well, the city of San Francisco is about 45 square miles. It has 900 miles of sewer pipes under the city of San Francisco. And it's bringing water and pumping water using a huge amount of energy. So what we calculated was how big an area would we need, assuming that the algae were going to take about 5 days to reach a harvestable, a five-day what's called retention time. So with a five-day retention time, we needed to accommodate 5 times 65 million. So we needed to accommodate 325 million gallons. And we know the size of our bioreactors, so we can estimate how many acres of land we would require to have that much water, either in a photobioreactor or in a pond. And that's what that graph, that diagram represented. And then we moved the whole thing offshore and made it a thinner, longer strip so that it wouldn't compete with the ship traffic that's in San Francisco Bay. It uses less than 1% of San Francisco Bay, which is a really, really large bay, and it would be sort of out of the way. The question is, do we really have the interest to develop this, and how would we go about doing it? People don't know this, but the Apollo program was a 14-year program that cost about $98 billion, 2008 dollars. In the Manhattan Project, for example, was a 5-year program that was about $22 billion. And if we were really serious about turning our energy system into some kind of renewable, sustainable system, we could invest in the Apollo-like program, but we're going to be talking about billions of dollars over the course of about a decade. Again, we're trying to replace a $5 trillion industry globally, but still, I mean, it's not clear that our government in this country is going to be willing to do a Manhattan Project to develop these types of alternative technologies. The point I was trying to make was that it can't be just focused on fuel, because fuel is a commodity and it won't be commercially viable that way. But if you build it into this integrated system, which I think we're all agreed upon, that we have fuel, energy, I used solar and potentially low-speed wind from vertical axis wind generators. There could, of course, be, depending on the currents, there could be submarine generation going on as well. If we start integrating these different systems, And we spent a lot of time figuring out how to recycle the wastewater. And there's a fairly good solution that we've come up with to make wastewater drinkable again. But the diagram I showed you of San Francisco was just the footprint that would be required for growing algae to use the wastewater from San Francisco. The production in biodiesel, assuming 1,000 gallons per acre per year, would be about 20% of the needs from San Francisco in terms of the diesel use in San Francisco. That's about what we could accommodate, 20%. By using more efficient methods, we can save probably 70% of the fuel just by improving efficiencies. So we're getting close to being a wash.
One question about affordability, because it's really a relative thing relative to the status quo. And I know that externalities are a real issue where the status quo is not paying for a lot of these things. So I was just wondering if the panel had some comments around how do we value externalities, how do we assess the cost of the other side of the equation so that the things you are working on can actually be deemed as more relatively affordable?
That's a loaded question.
You want to start?
Yeah, I think Jeffrey Sachs in a way spoke about that, but I totally agree that in order to make a kind of a, if you're talking about fuel as a commodity, you have to have the numbers to back that up. And I think the notion of the kind of, as he placed it, like the future of our civilization is in crisis, it's kind of hard to put a value on the various facets of what that means relative to climate, clean air, water, fisheries, you know, food. but I think that that would be a great collaborative project between the GSAPP and the School of International Policy and sort of our economics department. It seems to me that what one of the things that this conference can do is set some clear agendas, and I think that that would be a great agenda to set as a sort of a result of this discussion.
I think this point is incredibly important. I mean, the IPCC, which is a group of pretty well-renowned and respected scientists, are 99 or 95% in agreement that we're really in a catastrophic situation. And there's estimates that 40% of the known species are going to be extinct by the end of this century. In 90 years, 40%. This is the worst extinction since the Permian, 250 million years ago. And we are instrumental, or at least playing a role, in this massive extinction. But I mean, in terms of affordability, in Seattle, the oyster crop has failed because of what looks to be ocean acidification processes going on. I mean, there's huge amounts of affordability issues and externalities that we are more or less ignoring because we don't have a good alternative. Nobody has said anything that is really tomorrow going to be developed. And I mean, the Omega system is not affordable in its current conception, although we've worked on a system that looks like it would be affordable, but not compared to the oil industry. If you look at the EROI, the energy return on investment for oil, and you had a great graph of this, it was like about 100 in 1930. It's now around 20. But I mean, most biofuels are around 2 or 1. I mean, the Omega system, well, so wastewater treatment has an EROI of about 0.3. That is to say, you put in 3 times more energy than you get out of the system. And they get a little bit of energy from the methane produced from the digesters, which they recycle in their system. But your point about affordability and externalities is incredibly important, but what are our priorities, right? I mean, we don't value these things that we're talking about, extinction of species, well, ho-hum, I mean, so. I mean, it's really hard to put numbers on this. That's why I said it's a loaded question. But in terms of the long-term survival of our species in large numbers, we have to be sensitive to this. And I think we have to just get started down multiple pathways to be able to get to good endpoints.
I know there may be some questions remaining. I think because of time, we'll have to save them for the afternoon session. And I just wanted to launch one question into the afternoon panels before we end here. And that is, I think it's related to what you're bringing up, Kate. But my question is, what does this mean for the future of education, you know, or how does education respond to this? But maybe more specifically, I'm interested in you know, starting to discuss what kind of training it would require to create the kind of people who can design these integrated positive feedback types of solutions that take into account science and art, energy as well as water and waste, that design at multiple scales simultaneously from, you know, the DNA of algae, if that's going to be genetically engineered, you know, and DNA is the scale of something like 10 to the negative ninth meters, to the scale of the planet, you know, which you also showed, Jonathan, at a scale of something like 10 to the seventh meters. So, you know, we're talking 16 powers of 10 in the same project with all of these flows of people, natural resources like water and energy, and their impact on society and culture. You know, how could we possibly educate, you know, single individuals capable of this, but yet maybe we can, you know, revise our educational framework to somehow start addressing that. So that's my question for the future, but future panels. I want to especially thank these first panelists for kicking us off. So thank you, Kate, Dean, and Jonathan.